Welcome again to online worship with Johnson Memorial United Methodist Church. I'm recording today again from the glassed-in part of our parsonage, which sometimes we call the art room because I have bunches of art projects behind me and around me, but also because of so much light, it's also sometimes the plant room, which it certainly is right now as we prepare gardening and the growth that happens during this beautiful season of the year. I welcome you and I invite you now to put your heart and your mind and all that you are in a place where you can appreciate growth and possibilities and also the pleasure and the comfort that comes from worshiping God. So let's take a moment now and put ourselves in that place as we prepare together, even though we are apart physically, to worship God.
Oh,
My name is Debbie McGinnis, and I'll be reading today's Psalter lesson, Psalm 63, from the Common English Bible, a psalm of David when he was in the Judean desert. God, my God, it's you. I search for you. My whole being thirsts for you. My body desires you in the dry and tired land, no water anywhere. Yes, I've seen you in the sanctuary. I've seen your power and glory. My lips praise you, because your faithful love is better than life itself. So I will bless you as long as I'm alive. I will lift up my hands in your name. I'm fully satisfied as with a rich dinner. My mouth speaks praise with joy on my lips. Whenever I ponder you on my bed, wherever I meditate on you in the middle of the night, because you've been a help to me, and I shout for joy in the protection of your wings. My whole being clings to you. Your strong hand upholds me. But what about those people who want to destroy me? Let them go into the bowels of the earth. Let their blood flow by the sword. Let them be food for wild jackals. But the king should rejoice in God. Everyone who swears by God should give praise when the mouths of liars are shut for good. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. I'm Bernard McGinnis, and I'll be reading the epistle reading this morning from 2 Timothy chapter 1, verses 1 through 7 from the Common English Bible. From Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by God's will, to promote the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus. To Timothy, my dear child, grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, and Christ Jesus our Lord. I'm grateful to God, whom I serve with good conscience, as my ancestors did. I constantly remember you in my prayers day and night. When I remember your tears, I long to see you so that I can be filled with happiness. I'm reminded of your authentic faith, which is first lived in your grandmother Lois and your mother Eunice. I'm sure that this faith is also inside you. Because of this, I'm reminding you to revive God's gift that is in you through the laying on of my hands. God didn't give us a spirit that is timid, but one that is powerful, loving, and self-controlled. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. My name is Marilyn Murdoch, and I've been asked to talk to you this morning about a place that's near and dear to my heart, Lily's Place. Lily's Place is a neonatal abstinence syndrome center. There we have babies who have had prenatal drug exposure, and we provide the medical care and the therapeutic handling that gets them through this withdrawal process. It's located at 1320 7th Avenue. Cheryl Budd and I volunteer weekly to provide therapeutic handling to these infants who are so delicate and so fragile at many times during this withdrawal process. However, there's another thing that goes on at Lily's Place you might not be aware of. It's called our wellness clinic. Any baby who's been at Lily's Place after it's discharged is given the opportunity to come on a monthly basis to our wellness clinic. There we have a doctor who has volunteered her time to come and examine the babies, and especially looking at developmental milestones and making sure that everything is neurologically accurate with that baby for its age. We also have a representative from Right from the Start there and from the Birth to Three programs. And if the doctor feels that those babies need some additional support, then they can go right out into the next room and get it. And so they're signed up right there, and someone is taken on their case. And then they'll call on that parent, get them involved in other things that will help the child's development. One thing you might not know about Lily's Place is we have a new facility. It's called the Lily's Place Family Center. And it's located on 6th Avenue and 12th Street, right across the street from St. Joseph High School. There is where we house our recovery coach, our development director, our assistant director of development, our case manager, and ultimately our counselor will be in there too. And the purpose is to provide peer support right now for our families who have been involved with Lily's Place. But the end goal is that this is going to be opened up to the entire community. Anyone who needs the services that we can provide, right down to a clothing closet, can come in there and have counseling or have some connection to our recovery coach, or whatever they need. Even a clothing closet is there for them to pick things for their babies or for them. That's the end goal. Many people ask us, what can we do to help Lily's Place? Right now, we don't need volunteers on a weekly basis, but what we do need is just your support. It can be a project that you want to take on, or collecting things that we need, or more importantly, we have a new program called Be a Bestie. For $10 a month, you can join this program. Your credit card will be charged for just $10 a month for as long as that credit card is valid. Then you can renew if you choose. You can stop it at any time, but it's an automatic charge to your card. This provides a flow of money for services that we have to pay for. You know, we have to pay staff, and we have to buy other supplies, and there's always a charge involved with those. So this Be a Bestie is our new program to try to keep that continual flow of cash coming. So if you're trying to come up with something to do for us, consider that, or consider, you know, just taking on a project that we need, even if it's planting flowers in our flower boxes. That would be appreciated as well. Thank you.
On this day, let's take a moment to remember with gladness all the women who have blessed our lives, whether they are mothers, grandmothers, teachers, family members, friends. We have all been shaped by the women in our lives. So on this Mother's Day, let's pause for a moment to think about that. Let's also remember with gladness and with concern in our hearts those who are on our prayer list on the virtual bulletin. And now let's go to God in prayer. Loving God, thank you again for this day, for every day that you give to us. Thank you for the spring of the year and the ways in which life renews itself and reminds us of what a blessing and a miracle that is. We come to you with gladness this day for the women who have helped to shape our lives, whether they are biblical women, Mary or Sarah or Eve, or whether they are women in our own lives, our mothers, our grandmothers, those who have shaped us. We give you thanks and praise for their lives and ask that you help and shape us to be more like the qualities we admire in them. God, we come to you also with gladness for the other blessings we receive, for new life, for the ways in which love and community help to shape us, for the ways in which we're slowly but surely moving back to some kind of normal in this country and in this world as we continue to deal with the ravages of the pandemic. We're grateful that we have endured and that we are here. And now we come to you also with our concerns. The pandemic still rages in some parts of the world. More and more people are dying every day in India and other places, and we pray for them. We pray for medical workers. We pray for those who are sick. We pray for those who mourn. We ask that you help to shape our hearts and lives so that we can help others in your name. God, we come to you with concerns also for the changes in our environment, for the damage that has been done, and for the ways in which we continue to experience storms and floods and fires and other things on our planet.
God, we also come to you with concerns about places where there's war and famine and disease. We care about those places. We care also deeply about our own place, about Huntington, about Cabell County, about West Virginia, about the United States, about our world. And we ask your blessing and we ask your wisdom and your guidance in all that we do and all that we are. We pray for all the people who are impacted by our ministries here in this church. We pray for the people from Common Grounds. We pray for the children from PAC for the Future. We pray for the hospice house and all the people there. We pray for Lily's Place and for all the other opportunities and also ministries in this community where people and their needs are met by other people and their compassion. Help us, God, to be part of the solution. Help us to open our hearts and our lives in whatever ways you show us so we can help others in your name. We thank you for all the gifts you give us, and we thank you continuously during this season and every other for Jesus, whose life and death and resurrection has brought us the possibility of salvation and new life, and who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Without seeing you, we love you. Without touching you, we embrace. Without knowing you, we follow. Without seeing you, we believe.
The gospel lesson for today and the main sermon text comes from John chapter 15, beginning with verse 9. I'm reading today from the Common English Bible. Hear this, the Word of God. As the Father loved me, I too have loved you. Remain in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love, just as I kept my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy will be in you, and your joy will be complete. This is my commandment. Love each other, just as I have loved you. No one has greater love than to give up one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I don't call you servants any longer, because servants don't know what their master is doing. Instead, I call you friends, because everything I heard from my Father, I've made known to you. You didn't choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you could go and produce fruit, and so that your fruit could last. As a result, whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give you. I give you these commandments so that you can love each other. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. So the main sermon text for today is from John chapter 15, and we're going to talk some more about how God calls us to love. But first, I also want to mention the other passages for today, since it is Mother's Day. There's this beautiful passage from 2 Timothy, where Timothy's mother and grandmother are credited with being the people who passed the faith on to him. On a day when we remember our ancestors, especially the women who helped to shape our lives, it's a good thing to remember that in some ways, faith, like so many other things, is a little bit contagious. And if we are hearing that and learning about it from our mothers, our grandmothers, aunts, teachers, others, it helps to shape our lives in new and powerful ways. And if we are women, we have the opportunity to, again, pass that on to our children. The images in scripture are many, and some of them do include the idea that God is sort of like not just a loving father in heaven, but also like that mothering image as well. And I want to read one more passage of scripture today before I go into the sermon. This is from Luke chapter 13, verse 34. And again, I'm reading from the Common English Bible. Jesus is talking about Jerusalem and he's worried about Jerusalem, but this is the imagery he uses. Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those who were sent to you, how often I have wanted to gather your people just as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings. That's a beautiful image. I remember from my childhood going with one of my aunts to pick up some eggs from the hens in the hen house. Now, we had just gone and we had milked the cows. And so if one milks the cows and what you get is milk, then it made sense to me. So I asked my aunt, and now we're going to go egg the chickens? And of course, my family has laughed about that for years since. But again, we understand what we understand, and I was maybe five then. But what I did know was that the hens gave eggs, and sometimes those eggs became chicks, and sometimes they became breakfast. And both those things were awesome to me as a little girl. The imagery from scripture is about that nurturing sense of a hen gathering her chicks once she's had them and keeping them under her wings. Around us, the world is exploding with life right now. There are birds here at the parsonage in every tree. I hear them singing before it's even dawn, and I watch them as they go get berries and other things and take them to little nests inside of trees. And I appreciate so much that nurturing that goes on. If you're a United Methodist Christian, you probably already know that Anna Jarvis, who was a United Methodist Christian woman, created Mother's Day and pushed for Mother's Day in tribute to her own mother who had died. After Mother's Day became something that was celebrated nationally, Anna herself, according to everything I've read, was concerned that it had become a little bit too commercial and not really about paying tribute to the work and the beauty and the lives of our mothers. But again, today we think about it in both the small and the larger context. I hope you are thinking about the women who helped to nurture you, who gave you life and love and support, whoever they were. I also hope that you think about women throughout the world and the ways in which they continue to sustain life and to provide for others. And that you also think about the ways in which there are so many women who are suffering, who are poor, who are sick, who are hurting, who are having to make difficult choices in many parts of the world in order to try and protect their families and try and nurture their children. Those are difficult choices. And it's only, I think, by looking at the way God loves us that we can come to the place where we love others and try to support them like a loving parent would, like a loving sibling would. And so let me remind you again that Jesus says, as the Father loved me, I've loved you. I've given you everything I have, and I've helped you to understand things in ways that you couldn't have if you weren't an equal. If you were instead a servant, that would be different, but you're not. I've given you everything I have, and I've tried to give those things to you so that you might have joy, he says. And he says, I command you that you love one another. We've talked about this for weeks now, and actually we could talk about it for years because the whole Bible, especially the New Testament, talks over and over again about God's love for humankind and how that shapes us, and how if we understand how loved we are and we receive the gifts that God gives us, that then we are transformed in our own hearts and lives so that we can begin to be more loving, more intentional, more committed to serving others in this world. Right now, there still is so much brokenness in this world. And so in the same way that a mother loves her children, in the same way that a hen gathers her chicks, in the same way that God has loved us so much to sacrifice God's only begotten Son in order to give us this pathway to new life, to salvation, to the promise of a change in us that results in a change in the world. Because of all that, we are given this opportunity and we need to say yes. So I invite you again today, please say yes to God. Say yes to the possibilities. Begin to read this Bible all the way through, like especially the New Testament. But if you look at the New Testament and then you go back, you see that the imagery from it, the parts about growth and the parts about parenting and the parts about caring and community, those all trace all the way back to the Hebrew Scriptures. We have this opportunity again to learn and grow and become people who care about others. I'm not talking about doing that the way that the world gives peace, Jesus said in one of his last conversations with the disciples. He says, I'm not giving to you the way the world does. I'm giving the real thing to you. I believe that with all my heart. The real love, the real caring, the real community, that comes from faith in Jesus Christ and from a relationship that begins to transform you from the inside out. So again today, let's explore that together. Let's move forward together. And as we do that, let's give thanks for all the people who helped to plant the seeds that are growing now in us and in our lives. Amen.
As we prepare to offer ourselves and our gifts to God, I invite you to consider the online and in-person ministry that we do at Johnson Memorial. Today, we're doing a fundraiser for the Pack for the Future ministry, which supplies food to 40 children from Explorer Academy who otherwise would face food insecurity on days when the school doesn't meet or on school holidays. We're grateful for all the support. Let's offer ourselves and our gifts to God in gratitude for the ways in which our resources can make a difference in this world. Amen.
Thank you.
Oh,
service now has ended, and it's time for us to depart this spiritual place and move into the world at large. And so as we do that, let's remember that God, like a loving parent, goes with us, like watches over us, and also gives us the opportunities to grow and learn and receive both comfort and wisdom. I hope and pray that for you, for me, for all of us, this day and always. Go in peace. Amen.
As we part for the towns and cities, may your soul lead us to go. Guide us, Lord, give us strength and courage. Teach us all we need to know. Keep us all.